Hello and welcome to the Total Single Ministry. I'm Shelton and this is Tashara.
Hello everybody.
And we just have a podcast we want to share, video entitled Why Am I Still Not Married? And we want to deal with some of the issues that need to be addressed before getting married. Some of these issues can be hindrances to getting married. And so we want to deal with some of these issues just to bring to our single friends and, bring to your attention some things that could help you think about and things that you can work on. And a lot of this, you know, some of you, be encouraged because you may see that, hey, I'm already working on these type of things. So I hope you enjoy, and please remember to share and like this video if you like it, and leave your comments. We'd love to hear from you, and I'm going to pass it over to Tashara.
Awesome, awesome, awesome. Like my husband said, we want to address the reasons, why am I still not married? I know, you know, we all, you know, have been there and asked that question, especially the older you get and if you've never been married. But there are some issues that we must deal with before getting married, because if you try to unpack those things once you're married, it really does put a strain and even sometimes a burden on that spouse when you haven't taken the time during your singleness to thoroughly go through dealing with things from your childhood, things that you experienced through your teenage years and your adulthood years. So we want to be an encouragement to you today and go over some things that we've recognized in the lives of friends and our own lives and the research that we've done about marriage. And we pray that it is a blessing for you and that we will help you today to identify those issues that you no longer be in denial about them, but you walk in your place of deliverance. So number one, unhealed pain. And we hear that a lot in church, you know, you got to be healed, you got to be healed. And so if you are unhealed, you're the opposite of what healing means. And healing means to be healthy, whole and sound, to have full restoration, to be free from evil, to be cleansed, to be purified, to have a healed soul, and to be effective. And a lot of times when we have pain in our lives that is unhealed, that's pain that we still carry so much of it and so much of the mentality from the pain and how we've been victimized, that we don't walk in soundness, we don't walk in wholeness, we're not walking in our cure, we're not walking in our deliverance. And we really want to help you with that. We really want you to understand that if you get married and you have unhealed pain, it can be a great hindrance to the progression of your marriage in the formative years, in those first 2 to 5 years of that marriage. So take time now and really, you know, get your journal and write out all the pain that's going on in your life. Now, will you be able to, you know, go through every single thing? No, because there is a place in marriage that heals you from pain. There are some things that my husband and I, that we brought up from childhood and things that we had experienced and said, you know what, that's still a sore spot. That's a place that the Lord is still working with me on. But we were not in denial that we had not addressed the pain. We're talking about people who have unaddressed, which is unhealed pain. And this is the time when you want to write it out. I mean, everything, because it's between you and God, and really deal with the pain that's unhealed, the stuff in you that's not whole, that's not cured, and that you're still walking in the devastation as if the situation happened just the other day.
Yeah, that's good. This can be a touchy subject for some, and we know that getting through pain from the past, some of those things can be very difficult, but yet we have to face it at some point and begin to deal with it. A lot of these things are not an overnight process. You know, it takes time. But the thing is to begin to deal with it. We got several of these issues, and so we're gonna go through them. And maybe you go into the next one, or
yes, number two. Number two is distrust. distrust. When you don't have trust in something, that means you don't have confidence or hope in it. You don't find any strength or ability in that particular thing. And that's the first thing. You want to make sure that you're first trustworthy before entering into marriage. But you also want to make sure you marry someone who is trustworthy. You don't want to go into a marriage with distrust, because trust is a foundational principle in order for the marriage to work. So you don't want to be someone who's so distrusting that you're going through your spouse's phone, their emails, their social media accounts, looking for something. You know, there's an old saying that if you go looking for something, you're going to find something. And that can cause you to have anxious thoughts. It can cause you to always be paranoid if we really get real, and constantly accusing that person and making accusations toward that spouse. And that literally can drive that person insane, because nobody wants to be in an intimate relationship of marriage and not be able to be trusted. So really take time now to deal with, where did the root of that distrust in your life come from, and deal with it so that you don't bring that into a marriage.
Yes, and you know, getting through these things usually will involve another person sometimes, because sometimes we need help in getting through these issues and talking to others or someone we can confide in. And so find you someone you can talk to and at least feel comfortable with disclosing some things. And and by all means, you know, talk to God, pour your heart out to God. And we suggest premarital counseling too, you know, to deal with a lot of these issues, because they're bound by a code of ethics to keep their conversations with you confidential. So if you have a problem with trusting someone to even talk to, then that may be an avenue for you.
Yes, and we offer premarital counseling. We have a life coaching and consulting business and ministry. So we offer life coaching and mentoring. So if we go through these particular issues and you're like, hey, I really want to talk to someone, I really want to deal with that, we offer pastoral counseling. So absolutely, and we'll have all that information where you can reach out to us, and you can go through one of our many different programs that we have, and we address different things of addictions, abuse, various things like that. So we would love to, you know, be able to offer that to you if that's an avenue you want to pursue. The next one is selfishness and pride. When you're selfish, you are solely devoted to caring only for yourself. It's all about me, 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 me. And when you're prideful, you feel like you are so superior to another person that their opinion doesn't matter. If that is one of the issues that you're dealing with, I'm telling you now, that will not work in marriage. Because in marriage, you have to die to your flesh and yourself daily. You have to be a servant and not be selfish in marriage. And you can't be prideful, you know, in marriage. You cannot be where you feel so superior to your spouse that you make them feel demeaned, you make them feel belittled, and you come off condescending to them when you address them. So that's the thing you want to watch out for now as a single. Am I selfish? Am I willing to give up my last and my best for another person right now? That's easy to say if, you know, you're dealing with your child and you're a single parent right now, but I'm talking about for another adult. You know, you know, people always say, well, you have two hands and two feet, but when that person asks you, can you do this for me? And it's yes, and what time do you need it done by? You know, that takes a lot of strength. When your strength comes under submission like that, you know, and comes under control like that, that takes a lot. And in marriage, you have to be able to have submission and have a servant's heart in order for your marriage to thrive.
Yes, that's good. Number five, a lack of vision and purpose. And this is very important, because it helps you to, you know, knowing what your vision is and purpose is, or at least your goals, you know, goals that you have in life and the direction of, you know, that your life is going in, the type of things that you like, could be a good starting point for some of you. And comparing that thing to the person that you're dating or considering being in a relationship, because if those things are not lining up, especially those things that is really dear to your heart, you know, if you really have a vision and love to be around, you're a family person, you know, you don't want to move. You know, you're not going to want to move away from your family as far as the same city or what have you like that. And the other person, you know, is adamant about moving. You know, that's just one example. That can be, those things can be worked out, but there has to be a willingness. And that's what having vision and purpose can help, you know. Of course, it can get deeper than that, but, you know, have to take a look at those things. And sometimes the little things can create problems if we're not seeing eye to eye on the person that we're considering a relationship with.
Absolutely. And if you don't know your purpose, you won't be able to, maybe to identify that in another person. One thing that sealed the deal for myself and Shelton was the alignment of our purposes. And you can't be called to be a missionary in Africa knowing you're going to stay there and live in a hut for the next 10 years. And someone else that you meet, you know, you might really want to marry them, say, hey, I'm called to be a youth pastor in New York City. Again, it's not an alignment there. You know, you can't force a will that's not the will of God. Let me say that again. You can't force a will that's not the will of God. Now, you have your own, you know, will that you can walk in. But if it's the will of God, then the purposes and visions will be aligned with each other. And that is a clear indication. But if you don't know what you're called to do, it's very difficult to be with someone else when you don't have that clear understanding. Now, you may not know everything before you know, get married, especially if you're younger, listen to this particular podcast, but at least there should be some indication, just even through your passion, you know, of what you feel the Lord is leading and calling you to do. Another issue to deal with is desperation and loneliness. Loneliness is not the absence of a person. It's the absence of purpose, which ties into what we just said. So sometimes we can come off too desperate to a person, and that may be why that relationship didn't work out and why you still may be single, because you don't have to be desperate. You don't have to settle. You can truly wait on God that he will bring you his very best. And I think a lot of times some people get so desperate that they'll accept anything, and you'll start thinking, now I'll just change them once we get married. You know, nobody is a build-a-bear project. You know, when you marry someone, you marry them as is. And if you can't say yes in that moment and accept that person for who they are, then that will not be the person for you to marry at that time. Because when you marry someone, you marry them saying, if you never change from this day forward, I will still marry you. You know, and that's a hard thing to accept, because we all see potential in a person, but you never know if that person is going to maximize that potential once you get married. That's our hope, that's our prayer, that's our dream, but we don't go in trying to do that whole Build-A-Bear project on a person, because everybody wants to be accepted fully for who they are. So don't allow yourself to get so desperate or so lonely that you accept anything from anybody. All right. Another issue to deal with in singleness right now, if God is not number one in your life, that could be an indication of why marriage hasn't come. Because understand, marriage doesn't replace God. Marriage is, it goes second to who God is. God has to be number one while you're single, and number one when you're married. When I get up in the morning, the first thing that I am is a daughter of God. After that, then I am Shelton's wife, and so on and so on and so on. So relationship and prioritizing that relationship is key. If you try to misprioritize and make an idol out of your spouse, and God has already said he will have no other God before him, you know, no idols before him, then you will find yourself even feeling more lonely and desperate in your marriage when you misprioritize God. So again, really check and really ask yourself, is God number one in my life? Is God enough? If marriage wasn't for another couple of years, is he enough? And that answer should be yes. And if you can't answer that with an assurity within yourself, then that's where the work has to be done, where God is prioritized as number one.
And again, you know, these are issues that we're suggesting, and it is vital. You know, it can be vital to, you know, come in a marriage with an advantage if you deal with these issues.
Yes.
Because you know, we're not saying you're going to be perfect or have all these things just perfect, because that's not a reality, because you're going to have to deal with these issues even after you get married. But we're saying deal with these issues if you know there's going to is an issue that's really have you in a bad place. You know, deal with it and reach out for help to get to work through those things. Okay, so we're going to go to the next one.
daddy issues. Now, this can be twofold. It could be that your father was never in your life, or you compare every man to your dad if you're a female, where no man lives up to his standard. So let me deal with the daddy issue. When if your father wasn't in your life, you definitely want to deal with that, because you'll put unprecedented pressure on your spouse. And I'm going to talk to the women, and I'll let Shelton talk to the men. As a woman, you will put it'll be insurmountable. He won't be able to live up to that pressure of trying to pay back all the years your dad was not in your life. Even if you never met him or didn't know him, you will always feel like he has to make up and be that for you. You know, be that knight in shining armor. And no man can do that. Only God can be that and fill that void that you have. And then maybe you're on the other side where you had just a really great dad. I happen to, had a really great dad and was a daddy's girl prior to my daddy, going on to be with the Lord, so I had to deal with just constantly comparing the love that my father gave me with, other men. And I had to get my expectations in line of that was my father. Yes, he showed me the love and the proper care and respect, that I was supposed to have. But yet I couldn't put that kind of pressure on another man for everything my daddy did for me and provided for me. So it has to be balanced. So, you may have the daddy issue where he was an absentee father, or you may be on the other side where you were a daddy's girl and now no man can live up to him. That man has to be able to live up to the potential of who he's called to be as a man.
Yeah, and that's very different, from... a relationship between a father and a son, and a father and a daughter, as it relates to a husband and wife, those relationships are very different. Of course, love is there are some universal aspects of love, some of those things are acceptance, learning how to accept each other and to love in spite of our shortcomings, and just love us and be willing, to show grace and willing to work on a relationship.
That's awesome. I'm going to let Shelton tackle the issue about mom having a mom issue. Sometimes it's not a dad issue that you've had a mom issue, especially if you were a mama's boy. Your mama did everything for you, and now you're expecting every woman to cater to every beck and call just like your mama did. And that can be dangerous because, again, that's unrealistic expectation. So I'm going to let him speak to that.
Yeah, so there is... many issues that can come out of mama issues, and like Tashara said, I'm gonna speak from a man's point of view, and some of these things can be related to the women's point of view also. But as a man, there was some responsibilities that I had to learn how to deal with as far as mama issues. And I guess it was just, for me, it was dealing with a lot of immaturity, and learning to, not learning how to make decisions on my own. That's one thing that I hear a lot, and Tashara hears a lot too, mm-hmm. in counseling with others and coaching others, is that sometimes the man is not decisive, mm-hmm. they're kind of afraid to make decisions, yes. and things like that. And that's kind of, for me, that was some of the mother issues or what have you. I was so used to running to mom, yes. About this and mom this and mom that, what you think I should do in this matter. But I had to learn how to make decisions and not be fearful on making decisions on my own. I was really fearful of the consequence of if things don't turn out the way, I felt like it should turn out, then, that made me fearful to go forward with the decision. But that's just one aspect that I can relate to.
Yeah, and it's women, especially if you saw your mom maybe not acting in the most graceful way, if she constantly had men in and out of your home when you were growing up, or her and your father had a toxic relationship, or you just saw her have toxic relationship with other men, the way she addressed them, the way they addressed her, if you saw abuse, you have to be careful with that, because you, that could be a trigger for you, and you start acting out that same way even in marriage with someone if you haven't dealt with this issue as a single. So really ask yourself, you know, what have some of your past relationships said? Have they said, man, you got a nasty mouth, you petty, you cuss at me, you're disrespectful? I mean, really take to heart when people say that and you've been in relationships with them. You know, it really does, where, you know, it can hinder you. It really can. So really take inventory of the women in your family. I know we're particularly saying moms, but look at what influences have been in your family, and you really want to pull from the ones that have really been, you know, more biblical, and what the word says a woman should act and how she should be, but also learn from the mistakes of others, because some of the greatest things I've learned have been from other people's failures and their mistakes, and it saved me from not walking in that pathway.
All right, the next one is, you always have to be right, and a lack of submission. And, you know, I've learned years ago, or, you know, and still learning, you know, because it's one day at a time. You know, we deal with these issues, but we continue to learn. You know, I believe that when we get in marriage, it has to be, continue to be built upon, you know. So, of course, I have to learn how to accept the fact that I'm not going to always be right. You know, my spouse brings in a different set of views and experiences in life, you know, and I do also. And so, being willing to talk through things and hear the other person's point of view and respect their point of view, and just learn how to talk through things, and not always having to be right or feel like you're right, you know. And you will have issues where or times when, you know, I feel like I'm right, you know, but you still learn how to talk through those things, and give your reasons why you think you're right, and ask the other person, you know, why they think they're right. And so you can kind of try to understand their train of thought on why they view a certain thing a certain way, can be definitely helpful going into a marriage relationship.
Absolutely. And one thing that we do in our marriage, we always say we're discussing and we haven't made a decision. And you have to be careful when you've been the only one to make a decision about something, you know, for so long, especially when you're much older and you get married, because you're like, okay, well, I've already made a decision, this is how it's gonna be. That's not how it rolls in marriage. It is all about discussing, sometimes fasting over it, going to sleep on it, bringing it back up the next morning, and coming to a mutual understanding, a mutual agreement. So you have to be agreeable, you know, in order for you to, you know, really submit in that marriage, both the man and the woman. We're going to do one more, and then we're going to turn this into a part two event. We have so much to share. And like I said, it's just so rich when you're dealing with, why am I still not married? You know, and dealing with the issues that you have to address before getting married. So we're going to end on only wanting to get and not give. Now, this one is interesting, because you could become so self-focused about, well, I can't wait to get married so that I can, you know, finally have a ring, and I can finally, you know, have someone else is going to help me pay the bills, and I can finally have somebody that's going to help me raise the kids. And you're just constantly thinking about what you're going to get. When you're ready, really, really ready for marriage, you constantly focus on, what am I able to give? How am I going to be able to further their life and vision and the call on their life? What do I have as an investment of the gifts and talents that I have in me to pour into that man or to pour into that woman? So your mentality has to shift from getting to giving, you know, because in marriage, you will give and give and give and give and give. And you pray that it will be reciprocated and that you'll get, but you'll give even if you know that's not going to be part of it. And that is the ultimate sacrifice that you give in marriage. And that's the mindset you have to have. you know, that every day if they come in at 10%, you still bring your 100. You don't bring just 90, y'all to make up 100. You come at 100% every day, regardless of what's going on. And that can be difficult because you could be one of those days that your spouse is having a hard time and you feel like, well, man, I shouldn't have to do this because he had a bad attitude this morning. You still go ahead and cook that breakfast, fix that plate. I love you. I'm praying for you. And I pray you have an awesome day. And you check on him throughout the day and he still may not be reciprocating it. I'm talking to the women, and I know Shelton will share an example for the men, and you still are being that honorable wife of character and integrity, and you're allowing that to say, God, you deal with his heart. You change whatever's going on with him. And that's hard because we a lot of times like to keep score, and you cannot keep score in marriage. In marriage, you come with your 100%, you know, every day, giving your best, giving your all, even when you feel like sometimes you're not getting that from your spouse, because you'll have high and low seasons with that. But if you come with a giver's mentality, a cheerful giver, as the Bible says, then the Lord will begin to work that out on your behalf.
Yes. You know, two people coming together in marriage is, you know, we're sharing our lives with each other. And so that process of selflessness and practicing that on a daily basis takes practice. It takes a willingness and effort, and we can be intentional about it. You know, I've learned that even practicing giving on what some may think is a small matter, you know, can reap huge results. You know, for example, you know, just giving my wife, giving Tashara praise and other things that she do around here. She does a lot of things that I have the opportunity to praise her for. You know, babe, I really enjoy the way you cook good food. You know, she keeps the house clean and everything like that. And so that's an opportunity for me to give her praise, to show my appreciation, to give, you know, so. Again, you know, these are issues that definitely will help you before getting married. You know, our prayers that if that's your desire to be married, you know, our prayers that you be married because we believe that God desires for you to be married. Because if it's in your heart to be married, then that's a sign that God has someone for you. You know, so be encouraged. You know, if it seemed to be hard dealing with these things, and you may be like, I feel like I'll never get over these things. You know, God don't see as man sees.
Yes.
You know, we don't know the timing that God has for you to be married. You know, your dream maybe seem like it's broken, but God is in the business of fulfilling that which he has promised to you.
Yes.
And so, be encouraged, because we're working through these things with you, and God bless you. And make sure you listen to part 2.